Yay. Hi, everybody. I know some people are joining in from our last session. My name is Jade. I'm a community manager at Kids&Art Foundation and really excited for today's session. Sorry, can you guys hear me? I lost connection. Can someone give me a thumbs up in the chat? Oh. Okay. I'm echoing. Oh, you know what? Okay, sorry about that. Well, I'm here to introduce Marissa and Steve, who's joining us from a local group in Redwood City. They're Fete Fraiche, which I think it's French for fresh party, in conjunction with our nutrition talk yesterday. They've thought of some innovative ways to kind of present some vegan dishes, so plant-based, in some kind of flavorful just combinations, and I'm really excited for them to share. They're all about inclusive catering, and they have a Mediterranean and Californian influence in a lot of their work and projects. And they have a connection with Kids&Art Foundation where they catered our galas and some private events. So without further ado, I'm going to bring them on stage.
Hi, everyone.
Hey.
Thanks for tuning in today. We're so excited to be doing this session with you.
That's right.
I'm Marissa.
I'm Steve.
And we are Fete Fraiche in Redwood City, California. We do focus on inclusive cuisine, so this isn't a huge jump for us, but we do like to cook some good old home cooking as well. In conjunction with Lalit's talk from yesterday, we've put together a menu today that's vegan, clean, no additional oils, and no additional sweeteners. So everything in these recipes is super clean, super natural, and as unprocessed as possible. We have a couple of cheats for today just for speed, and we'll go over that with you. We're gonna be doing, actually, I'm gonna go back and say, hi, Corby, and also I'm very honored to be cooking on this day because it's Ame's day, and that's extremely meaningful. Corby and I go a long way back, but I'm not going to get into all of that right now. We can talk about that another time. Steve and I have been cooking together for about 2 years,
right.
And I'm going to let Steve talk a little bit about himself, where he's from.
Sure. I'm a reformed finance guy, actually. I worked in finance for 15 years and then decided to go to culinary school and get my hands into some food. So I've been doing that for the last 5 years and working with Marissa for two.
Yep. And I've been kind of on a similar trajectory. Didn't get too much of a career in the beginning, but I was a very long time not so stay at home mom, and got into culinary school in 2012 and started working professionally thereafter. So, we're passionate about food. We're passionate about healthy food, and we're passionate about flavor. So we want to make sure this is delicious, and we want to make sure we show you how easy it is. So we're gonna crank through a bunch of recipes. Take it away. What are we making today?
Hey, so our first one is a crispy buffalo cauliflower. It's got awesome color. And here's the recipe. So this is a great one because it has just so much good umami. Like, it's roasted, it's awesome. And then it has this spinach ranch dip with no dairy, but you're gonna love it. Tastes a lot like ranch, like surprisingly.
It does, and it looks beautiful too. And we're just gonna teach you how to cheat a little bit, how to crank up your flavor a little bit. We'll show you a couple tricks and some serving suggestions. The next recipe is gonna be our no tuna salad. It's actually made out of chickpeas, no tuna at all. It's really high in flavor. We added a lot of extra herb. These two recipes were inspired by recipes from Forks Over Knives, if you're familiar with that. We made some adjustments, and we also are going to teach you some ways to make this a speedier process than what it would be normally, so that you can get this out for your guests or for yourself faster and easier.
I like that.
Yeah. And our last recipe?
Ooh, Fete Fraiche original. It's an avocado fennel dip. And you wrote this one, right?
Yeah, just kind of, it slowly developed. And now it's completely clean. There's not even olive oil in it. Which, of course, like if you don't need to go that extreme, you can drizzle. But, staying true to what Lalit was talking about yesterday, we're going to keep this no oil, no sugars, no nothing. So this is one of my favorites. Everybody loves it. It looks amazing. And we're going to show you our little secrets to putting together a stunning crudité platter that is not boring at all. So, all right, ready to roll?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do this. Okay. Our first recipe, and I don't know if Jade wants to pop it up in a shared screen while we just super quickly walk through it, is going to be the buffalo cauliflower with the spinach ranch dip. So we have our ingredients right in front of us here. We're going to use a beautiful yellow cauliflower. Why are you using yellow?
It's Halloween.
It's Halloween. It's fall. We're going to do color, and the batter is going to have color in it from the paprika and the tomato paste that we're using. We're using the brown rice flour, and your recipe will say to use a little bit of almond flour. You can easily substitute that with rice flour or oat flour or something else, but the almond flour does give it a nice crunch. So up to you. You're gonna adjust your seasoning accordingly. We're gonna encourage you to taste your batter before you put your cauliflower in it. We're gonna actually season our cauliflower before it goes into the batter, which recipes don't say, but it's kind of, we always do that. So I think Steve is gonna teach you how to break down the cauliflower into florets. I'm gonna quickly tell you about our spinach dip. It's made with a silken tofu, so no dairy. That's gonna make it nice and creamy. Again, we're using some dry onion and garlic powder, a touch of salt. We're cheating and using frozen spinach, which is how we wrote the recipe. We normally just saute up some spinach or steam it, actually. We like to just steam and then let it strain and squeeze out the water. We'll show you how to do that. We're going to load it up with a bunch of fresh herbs and maybe reserve some for garnish. And we'll show you how to even platter it all together and then and make it look amazing.
Break down some cauliflower. Let's do it.
I'm going to start working on dry ingredients on my board, and Steve's going to show you how to break down the cauliflower.
So we'll just go back and forth here.
Yeah.
Beautiful whole head of cauliflower. I'm going to start by just tearing off these stems. And they're edible, too. If you want to leave a little bit on, it's totally fine. And actually, it's a little beautiful to have a little bit of greenery in there. So I'm going to leave a little bit of the stems in there. All right, so with the root end, I'm just going to cut it off here. Then, using the flat side of the cauliflower on the board, I'm going to cut it in half. This is the safest way to trim any vegetable, is to give yourself a flat surface, and that way it's not rolling around on the board. Okay. So to get really the beautiful florets that they kind of look more natural rather than they've been processed, what you can do is just sort of trim around where the stem meets the root naturally. And as you go around, you can actually just break them by hand so you get a natural break. You agree?
I do. You know, I just placed my water in the jar of the Vitamix. Any blender will do. We love our Vitamix. We're not advertising. Just can't live without it. I put my water in first, just that helps blend the ingredients easier. I'm going to put in my rice flour and almond flour next, and then my dried parsley, and then all the other spices, onion powder, garlic powder. I use smoked paprika. If that's not to your liking, you could do the sweet. And some salt and pepper all going in. We're going to taste this and adjust it accordingly before we get our cauliflower into it. And then you want to put your tomato paste in. And then it's just easy peasy. You're just going to have to put up with my noise.
Tomato paste is such a good ingredient. It's like, for the amount of flavor to like the tiny amount of paste, it's so awesome.
Agreed. Right? Yeah, I love it. All right, I'm gonna rev it up.
Okay.
Okay. Actually, I don't know if you guys want to see this happening because it might be so exciting. Yeah. You're gonna have to scrape it down a couple of times. And you could always add a little bit more water. It should be thick and smooth, but like quite thick actually. Just not dry.
So I've separated the florets here. You can kind of see the size. It's like 1 or 2 inch florets. They're nice. Good size for roasting. Good size for the plate. Again, kind of nice to break them along the natural seams like this.
I'm just adjusting my liquid in here. It needed just a touch more water. And then Steve, I think like the amount of batter that this makes, it might not be quite enough for this big head of cauliflower that we used.
Uh-huh.
Because I don't remember how much cauliflower the recipe calls for, like, I don't know, a few cups. We definitely have more than that.
Sure.
So we'll just toss and see what we can get. All right, I'm going to transfer to our bowl, and then we're going to taste it to make sure that this is what we want to put on our cauliflower. It's going to be a lot of blendering today. A lot of blending in the blender.
I do like the almond flour in this one because mm-hmm. it does give that crunch right at the end, which is... I don't see it very often. I think that's a nice touch on this recipe.
I agree. And yeah, I agree. I loved it. It's almost like when you use, you know, like a cornmeal.
Yeah.
And it gave it that level of crispiness on the bake. And it's like, you know, it's easy because once you get this in the oven, it's the perfect time to then make your ranch dip. So you won't be delaying very much. I'm going to pass that to you. So you can see this is really thick and pasty. We kind of want it like that.
Yeah.
To stick to the cauliflower. So I'm going to grab you a bowl and we can't season with oil, but just a little bit of salt and pepper. You can do it on your board.
Yeah.
And then we can throw in like as much as we think we'll get covered in here.
So I'm just going to pepper these with a little pepper and a little salt. My general rule is about 1% salt by weight. So I don't know, you can still guess, but like if you want to really measure it out, 1% by weight, it's about right. It's a good starting point.
Specific.
Yeah. Fun facts.
Fun facts. All right. 1%.
Okay. How much are you looking for? Just a
do about
like
half
this?
Of it, and then let's see what we get.
Yeah.
I think we can do more. I remember when I made it last time, I thought it wasn't going to go a long way. It actually goes a longer way than you think. So, but I just kind of, I'm a big fan of using my hands, frankly, so I might put some gloves on and get this baby to town.
Sure.
Yeah, I think we can do a little bit more. So I wouldn't keep adding water to make it looser because we're gonna bake this in the oven and you don't want your coating to be sliding off of the cauliflower.
Agreed. The vegetable itself has enough water on its own.
Exactly. What's gonna happen is this is gonna make this great crust around it and the cauliflower is gonna sort of slow roast inside of that. So it's gonna be very tender. but enough of the moisture will escape that it won't be, you know, wet inside. Your the other note I want to give you is it's important once you pull this out of the oven to let it rest for just a couple of minutes. The batter is going to be hot and still have a lot of moisture when it comes out. So just let it rest uncovered for 2 or 3 minutes till it crisps up, and then you could work on the platter again. So you could see it actually took that on pretty well. And then when you put it, I'm going to hand it to you and you could put it on the sheet pan.
Yeah.
This is the one occasion where we can definitely use a little bit of oil spray just to keep it from sticking. A touch of oil spray is allowed. And maybe not even necessary. Go ahead. Was there a question?
Yes, there's a question about Steve's comment about the salt. What does the 1% sweet mean?
That's on you, Steve.
What does it do? So salt will do a few things. From an experience perspective, it's going to open up your pores, or your taste buds, rather, and just make all the food taste better. So at a minimum, it's just going to taste better. But to the food itself, it's also going to break down the food just a little bit so that it gets tender while it's in the oven.
Okay. There's a question about oil that I think maybe you can touch on.
Okay. I can't see if there's a question written on the screen, so would you be able to read it out?
I was just wondering, is oil bad?
Is oil bad?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't think oil is bad, but what we're doing is we're following Lalit's guidance during this class. So I'm Greek. I can't tell you olive oil is bad for you. I cannot tell a lie.
Yeah.
I think olive oil is fantastic. However, Lalit did say there is one oil that for this diet is allowed, and that is mustard oil.
Oh yeah, mustard seed oil.
Yeah,
right.
Which we didn't source it for this. It's not necessary, but it has good properties, and that is kind of the one and only oil that Lalit would allow. Personally, I love olive oil. Normally my avocado fennel dip has olive oil in it. Today we're going to grind up the pitas. We'll get to that later. But you could substitute other fats, other fatty things like nuts or whatever, to fill in that fat for your recipe and get the good fat without using the oil. So this is a super clean cuisine where you're looking to not necessarily detox, but stop taxing your body, right? Would you think of it that way?
Absolutely.
What you're trying to do is take away anything that might be taxing to your body. And, you know, extra fat, extra oils. And we're talking about, like, take the whole 30 diet and kick it up a notch. Nothing is processed. Everything is from scratch. Like, I don't know if Lalit talked about this yesterday, but one of my favorite things that he said in explaining this to us was, if you can't make it with your hands, you can't have it.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, how about tahini? He's like, okay, that you can kind of make with your hands. So it's a little iffy, I guess. And, you know, technically I'm using a Vitamix. So if I'm going to start over questioning everything, I might ask, but, you know, I can mix this in a bowl. It wouldn't have mattered.
Or a mortar and pestle.
Right. Mortar and pestle. Exactly. So it's the same thing. You could, you know, you could like mash it with the side of your knife, you know?
Yeah.
So there are ways. And so we don't want to overthink it. What we're doing is we're trying to adjust to make things very simple. Stick to these guidelines as much as possible today. If you want to add oil to it, you know, that's up to you, but we're just trying to stick to Lalit's guidelines today and just kind of present one uniform thought process here across all of these classes.
All right, you guys, I'm going to put these in the oven. We've got it at 425. And it's ready to go.
Awesome. I'm going to move these babies here. They're going to be, actually, we'll leave them here. They look good. I'm going to move on to doing our super fast silken tofu ranch dip. This is a no-brainer, you guys. I have 12 ounces of silken tofu. It's gelatinous. Okay. Do you want to demo squeezing out spinach water? So I already squeezed most of the water out, and it was really cold. So, but Steve, do you want gloves? I'm happy. I'm not going to give you gloves because I don't know where they went.
Okay.
They're not where they are.
We washed our hands.
Yes.
If you're cooking at home, just make sure you wash your hands, of course.
Yeah.
All right. So spinach, you can buy it frozen or fresh. Either way, like if it's frozen, we definitely want to squeeze the water out of it. So I don't know if there's a lot of secrets here. We're just going to squeeze the water out of it.
I think you're all capable, but you know, in case we need to slow down a little bit so you can follow along, Steve's going to squeeze water. I have my silken tofu in here. I have my onion powder, garlic powder, a little bit of salt. I know it's not in the recipe, but you just can't not have any. And we can adjust it later. What's in here that's interesting is I put a tablespoon and a half of white wine vinegar. That's gonna really kick up that acidity. It's gonna bring out a whole bunch of other flavors. And that's what makes this not seem like just a spinach dip in conjunction with the herbs and stuff. So we're gonna add dill, parsley, and chives. I know we said chop them. I think we said chop them. But you know, if we're gonna blend it, why would you do twice the work? This is what we're talking about. It's like, you can cheat. Do not take off the stems. They're delicious. Please don't throw them away. And if you're gonna not use the stems for whatever reason, save them. And then you could use them in a stock, in a soup, to flavor anything else. You could throw them into a dressing to have a lot of flavor. I'm just gonna hand tear and throw in. I'm not gonna pre-chop because the Vitamix can handle it. If you're doing a food processor or a blender that doesn't have this kind of power, then you might want to chop them into like kind of like a rough chop or tear them in smaller pieces.
Yep.
But literally you just put everything in here. That's it. Put it all in there, pop it into the Vitamix, hope for the best. Ours doesn't have a top, so I'm going to make sure we put something there. Like this guy.
There you go.
All right, just break it up. I put a whole lot of herb in this one. And that's it, guys. What was that? 5 minutes? 3?
Yeah.
All right.
Easy.
Do you have a bowl for us?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, actually, you know what? We can transfer to any bowl because we're going to platter it up later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So that turned out looking gorgeous. Actually, before I do this, we should do what I said we always do, because we always do this multiple times. Better taste it. So, definitely needs more salt. For me.
Yeah.
More salt?
Touch more salt, yes.
Touch of pepper?
Yeah.
Why not? It's probably pretty good otherwise. May I have my lid back?
Yeah.
Sorry. The other thing that you might want to adjust is like adding just a couple extra drops of vinegar. I also have this fermented chili sauce. I'm gonna add it for a little heat, and it's quite acidic as well. It has all kinds of funky flavors.
So let's taste again. I love the tip about adding vinegar and even a hot sauce with vinegar. I would say like one of the differences between a professional cook and a home cook is the use of vinegar. And like Daniel Hume is a great chef, and his question is always, where's the vinegar? So anything you've got, really, like apple cider vinegar, rice wine vinegar, these are a little sweet, neutral, and can be used almost in anything.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I agree. I'm going to hand you that.
Yeah.
I'm going to slide you another ear. And now it tastes phenomenal. Would you like to try it?
Of course.
The other thing Steve and I were discussing is, what is a bunch of herbs?
You did it.
When somebody says a bunch of herbs, like what does that mean? Right? What's a bunch?
What is a bunch.
Let's talk about a bunch.
In general, if you go to the grocery store and you see herbs that are grouped together, it's in general about a 1-inch diameter of stems of an herb. That's about a bunch. Sometimes they come in the little like jewel cases with the clam box cases. But if you think about it in general, it's about a 1-inch diameter of herbs. Is a bunch.
Yeah, now I will say, I think I love adding herbs, so I'll usually add a lot more herb than what a recipe calls for. So I think that's one thing that you can safely play with all the time. Our buffalo cauliflower is baking. Our dip has been made. Time to move on to no tuna salad. No tuna. This is going to be for plating later.
Okay.
No tuna. All right. Want to take it away, Steve?
Sure. All right, this is another easy one and delicious. The first thing I want to talk about is chickpeas. You can buy them canned and you can buy them dried. If you buy them dried, like these, you need to soak them overnight because they're very dry and they're very dense and they won't become soft unless you give them a good 24 hours or a good overnight soak. So you can also buy it in the can, and they both work great. I know some people have strong opinions about canned versus dried. I've heard the arguments all ways, and I think it works both ways. So Marissa's starting here by taking chickpeas that have been soaked. These were actually from a can, and we're just mashing it with a fork.
And if another way to do a quick soak on the chickpeas, if you're in a pinch and you only have dry, is you could bring them up to a boil in some cold water. You could add a little bit of baking powder to that and simmer it down for 10 minutes. Then you can go ahead and rinse that out and put them in a fresh pot of cold water and then bring to a boil and simmer for about an hour. So that's a nice quick cheat if you really only have dry and that's what you want to use. But you forgot to soak them early in the morning or last night.
Right.
So it's okay if this is a little chunky. We're not making hummus. We're making a no tuna salad.
Yeah.
All right, so that's done. Cool. What else is gonna happen right now, Steve?
So we're gonna do some 101. We're gonna dice an onion real quick.
All right, let's show them how to do knife skills 101.
correctly holding a knife. Very common is to do it like this. Not correct. Also not correct. The tennis racket grip, not correct. Mm-hmm. Correct way to hold a knife is basically you can make an okay sign and put your thumb and your index finger right here on the bolster. And then other three fingers wrap around. So you've got two fingers actually on the blade itself right next to the bolster. Okay. So dicing an onion. You've got the stem end and the root end. I'm going to trim the stem end and leave the root end. Cut the root end in half, that. And then for today, I really only need a quarter of an onion. So let's peel it.
And I'm just gonna go ahead and whip up what I'm calling the dressing, or the wet stuff that goes into the recipe.
Uh-huh.
I've got 4 tablespoons of tahini. I'm gonna show you a quick cheat while Steve's peeling his onion.
Yeah.
We're gonna zest some lemon in here. I never waste the zest, so you can zest it. This is one way. If I'm zesting a lot of lemons, I do something that a lot of people have an issue with, but it works awesome for me. I just do that and it stays right on your microplane grater. And then you can just tap it all out. So if you don't like it, don't do it. If you wanna judge me, it's not my problem.
Would recommend the microplane. That's a great tool.
Quick cheat on the garlic. You don't have to dice it by hand. You don't have to mince it by hand. Just go ahead and use your microplane zester for that too.
Okay. So for the onion, I've peeled half an onion. And then the first step that I do is to just slice the onion carefully towards the root end. Now I'm gonna do cuts towards the root end again, vertically. Turning, and then here's the fun part. You get this beautiful dice. And then, don't like to waste anything, so I'm just gonna trim up the end here. Okay. So then I only need a quarter cup according to our recipe. Great. So Marissa, I'm gonna give you about half of this.
Sounds good. Well, the one note that I made on this recipe was, you know, this is our tahini dressing, as I like to call it. Tahini gets really dry. So I always thin it out with some water, and then we did add the lemon juice as well. So I'm just gonna go ahead and slice my lemon in half.
Perfect.
And juice that in there. But I found the lemon juice wasn't enough to keep it hydrated. In conjunction with the chickpeas, it just got super dry. So feel free to thin out. Like, even when you're done, it's okay to just incorporate a little extra water into your salad. All right. I wonder if anybody's cooking along.
Wonder.
Jade, will you tell us if anybody's cooking along? It's kind of challenging, but I wonder if anybody tried.
Yeah.
Yes?
So when we're peeling an onion, does anyone know how many layers to peel? See if anyone responds. If not, I'll just tell you.
You're Mr. Trivia today. I love it.
All right, if there's no guesses, the answer is whatever it takes to get rid of the papery layers. If you've ever tried to chew onion paper, it's unpleasant. So the first layer, of course, is paper. But if you find that the second layer also has a paper layer, just take the whole thing and be done with it.
You don't have
a response for two layers.
Yeah.
You stomped them. It wasn't a number. It was a trick question. It was kind of like a Shrek question. Okay. Kind of like a Shrek thing. Oh, no. So we've just put in our tahini goody stuff in here. We're going to add Steve's.
You ready?
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. And I'm going to go ahead and add the celery that we pre-diced and the pickles. We have some capers. Now, if there's something in this recipe that you're not very fond of, you don't have to include it. If there's something you want
sunflower
more
seeds.
Of, feel free. We added sunflower seeds. You could add more. It's totally up to you. It's whatever you like. I think we can move this way.
One more, darling.
I put it into
all
the tahini
dressing.
Yeah. All right.
I got you.
Thanks, sir. And then we're just going to mix this all up, and we're going to incorporate some fresh chopped herbs. We didn't bring them out with our setup because we have a whole little setup over there of fresh herbs and pots. And my point with this recipe is, you guys can put whatever herb you like. If you could put one herb, you could put a mixture of herbs. I think we did a lot of parsley and cilantro and green onion or whatever. And I actually would love some mint in here. I think it'd be really yummy. Although it veers away from the typical tuna salad, but I don't know that we care about that.
So we've got mint, we've got basil.
Steve, do we have a timer on the buffalo?
Fresh parsley.
Do we have a timer on the buffalo cauliflower?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we don't. But we can.
We'll look at it. If someone were to smell.
Yeah. If someone were to forget to set a timer,
which we do.
Yeah. How would you check it?
Well, I always just open the oven door and see what it looks like. Sometimes I touch it. And I'm going to guess it's been 10 to 15 minutes. So I'm going to walk over and check our cauliflower while Steve clip some herbs. I'll be right back.
Okay.
I would almost go double that.
Sure, I can do double that. All right, so we're gonna do a ton of basil here. So the volume, the recipe calls for a quarter cup of herbs, but when we chop this, like the volume is gonna go way down. So you're gonna get a lot. So a lot of basil, we have a lot of parsley here, some fresh parsley. Some good basil.
Beautiful.
Oops.
I'm gonna pull out our, actually if you can grab, when you finish clipping those, if you can grab your platter for plating these up, I can be ready to plate it up. I'll just go right here.
Okay. All right, so we have a pile of mixed herbs. It's whatever you guys like. You can't screw it up. It's going to be delicious. So to get this into a nice chop, and truly, like, this is what we do. I'm going to fold it into a ball. Kind of keep it tight. I've got stems and all. And then in order to get a fine chop on it, I'm gonna hold it tight and just go through this ball with about 1/8 inch cuts, and then we'll go over it again at the end. So keeping it tight.
So Steve's kind of doing what we call a chiffonade, little ribbons, and then he's gonna go through and chop it finer. This bruises the herbs less, and especially if you have a really sharp knife. If you don't have a sharp knife, it's gonna be brown real quick, but you know what? This tuna salad, the no tuna salad, is not gonna last very long. I just tasted it, and it's even better than Even better than before I redid the recipe. So now the recipe's good. We know that.
I know in culinary school they taught us to mince the herbs so fine, but I think the culture has changed a little bit recently where it's kind of nice to see what the actual herb is and what the shape of the leaf is. So I'm not going to mince too fine. I still want to know that, oh, this is a mint leaf or this is a basil leaf. But just small enough so that you don't get it stuck in your teeth.
Try not to. And I love to use like whole leaves just torn right off the stems for salads or garnish even. It looks really pretty. I think we're going to do that with our buffalo cauliflower. Or we just decided we will. Going to show you how.
All right, you ready?
Yeah, hit me.
Here we go.
We're going to show you two various ways to do this. We could do like a proper sandwich using whole grain bread. Bread is okay to use. It's not a gluten-free diet unless you need to be gluten-free. We already have planned for that. So if you are gluten-free, this is what we look like. I wonder what yours looks like. Feel free to send in a snapshot if you're making this.
That'd be awesome.
That'd be super fun. We were thinking maybe you want to make it like a lettuce wrap because I think it looked beautiful and why not?
Yeah.
So those are kind of ridiculously big for that. We have fresh cut tomatoes, and actually we could definitely put lettuce in our sandwich too, right?
Yeah.
So I like to load it up. I love tomatoes and lettuce and onion. And if you don't want your onion to be so strong, you could just salt it in the beginning and let it kind of sit with the salt, take some of that out, and then take some of the bite out of it, and then you can go ahead and rinse it and pat it dry.
Yeah. I think that helps too, rinsing in water.
And clearly I don't know what I was thinking because I should have really built my sandwich on the other one and put all the leafy greens and stuff on top, but
it'll work.
I was trying to make it look pretty for the camera, and you know, don't do this at home. Definitely build it here and then put your tomato and onion on top. All right, I am happy with our Sammy.
Marissa, do you cut your sandwiches diagonally?
Such a tough, I like cutting them on the diagonal. I do. I don't know with a sandwich like this if that would be a good idea. I mean, it's got a lot of filling that can fall out. I mean, but this is kind of a large sandwich.
It's a big one.
I would definitely cut it in half. Shall I just go for
it? Yeah, let's see it. What do you
got? With my non-serrated knife. So our thought was like you could put a little pig on it. Look how pretty that looks. It's a loaded Sammy. And then we thought you could just scoop into here. We can put like a slice of tomato in here.
That's a good idea.
If it doesn't make it slippery and messy. You could just leave it open like that. People can just grab. It's a great snack, but an awesome lunch. I could see how like you could even serve it up as an appetizer if you wanted in a smaller lettuce cup or an endive or something. So this is our little sandwich board set up for you guys. I'm gonna move it aside. Hope you guys see that. Okay, and I believe Steve is pulling out the cauliflower right now. Should we platter it up real quick?
Sure.
Okay, let's do it. Sorry guys, we're still here. We're still here.
I have to say I'm pretty happy with how this turned out.
Ooh, I think the looks color gorgeous. Is amazing. So we're gonna now wait for it to cool down a bit and crisp up. And then we'll
have to send us like closer shots after the session.
Sorry?
Are you going to have to show us a closer shot of the dishes later on?
When we're all done, you want to see a shot of all the plated dishes? Yes, that was our plan. I'm just setting them aside, and then we'll pull, and we'll do a little buffet table.
Yeah,
we're going to come in and like, yum, it looks great.
Okay, hold up, this one is close. Awesome. So this is going to be our cauliflower platter. And my thought was that we could, of course, people always want extra dip, or so I think. So that's what we're going to go with that.
You know me.
So, no. Who doesn't want more dip? So we're going to put some dip into our bowl. Put a little spoon in there. And I just love to undersauce because that way, if it slides off of the top, you got it on the bottom, so not to mention it might look super cool. So we'll just do that.
Nice. Ooh. Pro move, Marissa.
I know. It's just we kind of need to wait a minute. Or should we just cheat? They can cool here. So just wait 3 minutes on yours. Trust me. You want to wait 3 minutes. So pretty. See how that paprika and the tomato paste just really added to the color of this? And then you have the yellow cauliflower, which is just lovely. I don't want to like overcrowd it because I don't want them to steam, but. And then, what do you think? I don't want to over.
What do you think about a little lemon juice?
We decided this recipe definitely needs a little lemon juice and lemon zest because you can't go wrong with lemon juice and lemon zest. I'm just going to give them like a little dab.
Yeah.
You could definitely thin this out a little more if you want it to be more like a drizzle, but we're going to show you what we're planning on doing with it. Oh, I had microgreens that I forgot to call. That's okay.
Sure.
You want to do a little zest.
Sure.
And here. And then we were going to go ahead and drizzle a little lemon juice. And we were going to also heat it up with some hot sauce, which should be.
Grab that too. I have it. I'll bring it.
Oh, you have it. We have all kinds of hot sauces here. That's our favorite, the fermented one.
Little over here too.
Yeah.
Why not?
Yeah, I love it.
Okay. Back to you.
Beautiful. I will do some lemon squeezing. So the acidity of the lemon is going to not only amplify the flavors of the dip, but also it'll bring out some of the spice from the cauliflower batter. So helps to balance it out. And we're going to hit it up. Which one are we using now? Is that the Cyclone?
This is Cyclone, yeah.
I love the Cyclone.
It's nice. Or actually, all right. Yeah.
Or cayenne, it doesn't matter.
You drop.
It's all good.
A little heat.
Just a little heat.
A little acid.
All right.
Nice.
So this is our cauliflower bladder. We're going to show you a full table of all the platter food when we're finished, but now we want to do the avocado pesto. So guess what you're going to need for this recipe? Can you guess?
Avo fennel? Oh, we're going to need fennel and an avocado.
But what equipment are we going to use? Vitamix.
Oh, of course, another Vitamix. Keep it easy.
Keep it simple. All right, another Vitamix. And here are our ingredients for our avocado fennel dip. We're going to use one head of fennel, one bulb. This is for our other special little demo. Sorry, I don't know where our little secret sets went. Oh, here they are. Here we go. I'm going to set this up next to you or I can do it, shaving the thing later. But Steve's going to demo the safest way to clean your avocado.
You guys, my doctor friend recommends cutting an avocado this way because he sees so many accidents from people trying to cut an avocado in their hand, just in the air. So the suggestion is just to put the avocado on the board. We'll score it in half around the pit. I know everyone's opened an avocado before, so I know this is not new ground, but we're just gonna do it the safe way, right? Let's see this. Let's turn.
You have a lot more control when your food's on the board versus in your hand.
Loose.
So avoid the accident. I'm just zesting the lime because, like I said before, I never throw that stuff away. If you're not going to use it, I highly recommend you just zest it. You could put in a little piece of wax paper and stick it in the freezer in a Ziploc bag and pull it out when you're making something else where you can use it. So I'm squeezing out the juice of one lime, and I have the zest of one lime. I have a backup just in case because, like we said earlier, we're going to adjust for acid and heat and salt and decide what we like. So that's done. And you're going to work on avos.
Sure.
You pop them in there. I've already measured out salt and pepper that was in your recipe. Some water in case we need to thin it down. We're going to add pepita, some pumpkin seeds, instead of olive oil in this. And then what I have is I have some scallions. I have 4 good-sized scallions. I have a generous bunch of cilantro, so we might not use all of it. And I have a good bunch of chives. Right now I'm going to show you how to trim down the fennel bulb. I just cut the root end off, trim the fronds off. The fronds are awesome. You should be using them. If not today in your avo fennel dip, you can use them in something else. I'm going to definitely use at least this much of the frond. And then we'll reserve this. This has a lot of flavor, the stem, just like the bulb. And then you can balance it off because the stem and the frond, all the
we'll
show you what not to do.
Yeah, what not to do.
We don't want that. The frond has a very different flavor from the bulb. So stronger, I would say. The frond, the bulb is like super mild and it's got that anise flavor, but it's very mild and it's great. This is much more anise forward. Okay, I'm just gonna quarter this. And can we bring this between us?
Yeah.
Oops. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions? Comments?
We had to put some comments on some herbs that people like.
Oh, great. You want to read them off?
parsley, oregano, basil, thyme, rosemary, cilantro, mint.
Basil would be great in this. I personally wouldn't do oregano and thyme, but it's whatever you want it to be. As a veggie dip, it's not what I'm going for. It's got lime in it. It's just not what I'm going for. But you should totally feel free to try it and then make your adjustments. I don't see why not.
Right.
You might, okay, here's my suggestion. If you're gonna do like oregano and thyme, maybe try lemon versus lime. What do you think? I feel like the lime's like bitter, oregano's very bitter.
I think that's right. Or also like the Mexican oregano has a little bit of a mint flavor on it.
Yeah. So play with it.
Yeah. You ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Everybody in?
Okay, like I said, I've got a lot of cilantro here. I might tone it down a little bit. Although, there's no such thing as too much. Again, I'm going to cheat, right? We don't need to make more work today. We have like 8 minutes. Are we going to do this, Steve?
We're going to do it. We're going to make it.
We're going to do it. I'm just putting it all in. Forget it. It can't be bad. There's no such thing as too much herb. So I don't remember how much. Yes.
Oh, no. Someone earlier commented on how they love how you use the stem. So I think they would appreciate you filling the Vitamix.
Sorry?
Oh, earlier, when you were like, use the stem. We got a lot of like feedback, like yes, he's, you know, supporting of the use of the stem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have Steve demo this while I blend. It's going to be a little loud, but we're going to show you a way to make something stunning and gorgeous to put on your crudité platter. I have watermelon radish. I'm going to show you what else I'm putting on my platter later, but we're going to use a Japanese slicer and an ice bath. The ice bath will make this veggie like curl up, and we're gonna cut them just thick enough that they'll hold. They're gonna make a beautiful like dipping chip, and it's raw, beautiful food. It's gonna look beautiful.
It will.
Amazing. Oh, I just do it right into the ice bath.
Okay. Guess yeah, I can see.
Who's that? Oh yeah.
So I'm gonna go pretty thin, well, like a 16th of an inch.
Yeah,
just like a matchstick, like half a matchstick, maybe.
That's perfect.
A little thick on that.
That's a little thick, but like, I mean, not that you guys can tell exactly how thick it is. I think our slicer is not slicing perfectly evenly across the way. I'm going to crank this up. You can watch Steve slicing. I always say in my kitchen, your fingers are much more valuable than saving the vegetable, okay? You can save those ends and use them in something else, but please stop slicing.
I will show you how to correctly stop.
Thank you. Yeah. You can use a food processor as well. It won't be as smooth, but it doesn't really matter. You can have a chunky dipper spread. We're just trying to minimize the number of pieces of equipment we have on this table.
Pretty darn good.
It's delicious, but it definitely needs, guess what, more salt and more lime. So these avocados that we used today were actually quite large, and when I wrote the recipe, it was like I should have specified. I was thinking about this yesterday. just like a Haas avocado, nothing humongous. Or like even if you use the small ones, just know that based on the size of your avocado, you're gonna adjust how much herb you put in and how much liquid you're gonna add, and also how much acidity and salt and pepper you want. So it's a matter of personal taste as well, but you'll find salt and acid are gonna make a big difference because there's a lot of fat in the avocado. So I'm gonna cheat this one time because we're running out of time and I'm not gonna zest this lime. But let's do this. And then Steve, you wanna, I'm gonna take these guys for garnish. And yeah, then if you want to clear that and bring our platter, we'll platter this up and then we give you a quick little show of what we created. So I just did half a lime more. You could do less than that, or if you feel like it's way under on acid, you could do more. All right, hopefully this is perfect. You know, I'm going to tell you it's perfect because we're going to move on and show you how to plate it.
It is perfect.
Nice.
So all I added was half a lime more and a pinch of salt. It made a huge difference. So don't add too much at a time. It's better to adjust multiple times than to go crazy and then over season or something. I'm pressing over here. Beautiful. So yesterday, we set these up so that they're already curled up and beautiful. They were sitting in an ice bath. I have watermelon radish, but I got a little crazy and I thought, what about a golden beet? And it is so beautiful. And I decided to keep the skin on because I thought it was just lovely. I'm going to show it to you.
It's a really beautiful
It's
contrast.
So gorgeous.
Yeah.
And this whole like beet and watermelon chip, we call them chips, idea just came out of nowhere. I don't know. I was just like, we had something to do for a client and I was bored with crudité. And I was like, oh, what if we do this? This might work. And then when we plattered it up, I kind of even stuck them in the dip and they just looked so pretty. So I think, let's go wild.
Amazing. I think we made everybody really hungry. Everything is so close.
Yeah. I'm just going to plate while you talk, Jade.
As we are closing, just want to make sure people are, you know, looking forward to the next one. You can just stay here on CrowdTest and you'll be brought into the next session. But, you know, wanted to, you know, if you can follow Marissa and Steve on their website, I put your Instagram in the chat. They are doing, you know, meal delivery during this time. So if you are living in Redwood City or South Bay, Marissa, maybe you can
check me. I don't know how this is looking on.
Yeah, I think we see half of the plate, so, yeah.
There we go.
Yeah.
Better? So you could put them in there just so people know, oh, you could scoop with that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, hey, I mean.
It's a good point.
It's true. People sometimes don't think that far. I'm looking for something to do a little smear. Yeah, because you already know I like to do this. We're gonna do that.
Nice plating.
And it'll kind of keep your veggies in place too. You don't have to do any of this. You could put it all in the middle and swirl around it with a spoon and set the veggies like that, or set veggies around it. But, you know. Let's do a little gang action. That didn't work out.
Yeah, I see it.
Just have to think creatively. It's the yin and the yang. Doesn't matter. Because, you know, we don't want to take ourselves too seriously because it's just food, right? It is just food, folks.
You guys are going to eat it right after this.
Yeah, please.
All right, shall we do a little showcase of
yeah.
what we've got? Oh, and then we thought you could also totally sprinkle some extra pepitas on there if you wanted.
Love it.
All right.
Okay, so I'm getting, we will be closing. So if you guys are, you know, first time here, this is part of the Aki 2020 Summit. And this will be recorded and I'll be sending out recipes and shopping lists. Thank you so much, Marissa. Thank you for joining.
Thank you
for having us, guys. I'm just going to tilt it so you
can. Yeah. Awesome.
Okay, I hope everybody enjoyed it, and I hope you all get cooking at home. We'd love to hear from you.
Yeah, thanks so much, you guys.
Thanks. Enjoy the rest.
Hi, my name is Bianca Lee Van, and I'm chair of the Artist Committee for Kids&Art. If you liked the video that you just watched, please consider donating by visiting kidsandart.org/donate. Kids&Art is able to provide free workshops for pediatric cancer patients through donations like yours. Thank you.